However, CBS will carry the game in its entirety on a slightly delayed basis.
Falcon Crest will not be seen tonight.
That's impossible.
So that we may bring you the following special.
I'm thrilled.
It will return in 2 weeks at its regular time.
The NCAA tournament seemed to bring out the worst in Ray Meyer's DePaul teams. In 1981, DePaul, the number one ranked team of the nation, was upset by St. Joseph's. In 1984, Ray Meyer's last season at DePaul, they were eliminated by Wake Forest in overtime, losing on this basket. Ray left frustrated and passed the coaching reins on to his son, Joey. Joey has struggled trying to replace his legendary father. In fact, earlier this season, many doubted DePaul would even be selected for the NCAA tournament. But they were, and this year as an underdog, DePaul has turned the tables on its opponents. Is it possible that Joey might help DePaul overcome their past tournament failures? DePaul has met every tournament challenge thus far, but now they must face the ultimate test, the Blue Devils of Duke. Duke's the ACC champions and the number one ranked team in the nation. They're a powerhouse that features college basketball's top backcourt. Tommy Amaker and this man, Johnny Dawkins, Duke's all-time leading scorer. The Duke players and their fans are expecting nothing less than a national championship. Can DePaul deny them a trip to the Final Four, or will Duke fulfill what they believe to be their destiny? Welcome to the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey, for the semifinal game in the East Regional between the Blue Demons of DePaul and the Blue Devils of Duke. Hi, everybody. I'm Gary Bender. The consensus of opinion was that DePaul, with a 16-12 regular season mark, would not get into the 64-team field. They did, and two surprising victories later, they have a crack tonight at the number one ranked team in the country, the Duke Blue Devils. And Doug Collins, they look at this as a real opportunity.
Gary, when you look at DePaul, Joey Meyer changed his lineup for the 13th time on the last regular season game against Marquette. He's got four seniors starting now. They don't want their season to end. On top of that, you've got to add Dallas Comagenes is coming off the bench and giving him the offense, but more importantly, mentally, he's accepted that role.
Doug, Duke has had an outstanding year. They're the number one seed, the top-ranked team in the country, the longest winning streak in the country at 18. Yet, if they would lose tonight, they might consider this an unsuccessful season.
When you talk about Duke, you talk about a well-balanced ball club. Everybody knows about Johnny Dawkins and Mark Allery. They're all Americans. They're well-balanced. They love to play pressure, man-to-man defense, force you to get into an up-tempo basketball game.
The first meeting ever between Duke and DePaul. We'll be back with introduction of the starting lineup for the semifinal game in just a moment.
Tonight's East Regional semifinal game is sponsored by Mercedes-Benz, engineered like no other car in the world. Exceptionally smooth Michelob. Where you're going, it's Michelob. And by Michelin. Michelin, because so much is riding on your tire.
The Paul game you're about to see here on CBS actually tipped off about 20 minutes ago. That's because of an NCAA rule that prohibits games from starting past 9:45 local time. Now also coming up is Kansas against Michigan State, and we'll have live updates for you on that game from the Midwest Regional. One final in from Kansas City, North Carolina State over Iowa State by 4. The Wolfpack dominated inside. It was Chris Washburn with 20. Here he is on the follow. Jim Valvano only one game away from going back to the Final Four. Now sit back and enjoy DePaul against Duke. Let's go back to the Meadowlands and rejoin Gary Bender.
DePaul and Duke squaring off against each other in the semifinal game in the East Regional. And now for the announcement of the starting lineups, the public address announcer, Dom Alleghia.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Brendan Byrne Arena for this evening's Eastern Regional semifinal game between the DePaul Blue Demons and the Blue Devils of Duke. Now let's meet the starting lineup for DePaul. At forward, a 6'11 senior from Chicago, Illinois, number 32, Lamont Lampley. For Duke, at forward, a 6'5 senior from Drury, North Carolina, number 12, David Henderson. For DePaul, at forward, a 6'8 senior from Los Angeles, California, number 34, Kevin Holmes. For Duke, at forward, a 6'8 senior from Scottsdale, Arizona, number 32, Mark Allery. For DePaul, at center, a 6'9 senior from Flint, Michigan, number 51, Marty Embry. For Duke, at center, a 6'8 senior from Rolling Hills, California, number 21, Jay Phillips. For DePaul, at guard, a 6'3 freshman from Bronx, New York, number 10, Rod Strickland. For Duke, at guard, a 6-foot junior from Falls Church, Virginia, number 4, Tommy Amaker. For DePaul, at guard, a 6'5 senior from San Francisco, California, number 20, Tony Jackson. For Duke, at guard, a 6'2 senior from Washington, D.C., number 24, Johnny Dawkins. And introducing the head coaches for DePaul in his second season, Joey Meyer. For Duke in his sixth season, Mike Krzyzewski.
Going to be back with the opening tip in just a moment between these two clubs. Doug Collins, let's take a look now at the keys. First for DePaul.
Well, and I think that for DePaul to win this ballgame, they got to handle the pressure defense of Duke, the tough man-to-man pressure. They must get on the boards, use their physical strength inside, and they must get back well defensively against this Duke fast break.
On the other hand, for Duke?
Duke wants to get into an up-tempo game. They do that with their defense. They want to contain Comagies off the bench, and they want to get to the boards and stay out of foul trouble on the inside.
After the tip, Duke will be awarded the basketball. While Duke has won 18 in a row, DePaul has won 3, a season-ending victory that was very important to get to the tournament. They beat Marquette, and then they continued on to defeat Virginia and Oklahoma in Greensboro.
Gary, right now we see DePaul opening up in man-to-man defense. I think they'll maybe show it a couple possessions, but look for them to get back into a zone early in this game.
The all-ACC forward, Mark Allery, has it stripped away by Tony Jackson. Holmes brings it out. Here comes Jackson to Rod Strickland. Strickland off to Lamone Lampley. He misses, and Holmes follows, and DePaul is on the board.
Well, there's that inside power we spoke of DePaul. Lamone Lampley with a missed jumper, but a strong rebound by Kevin Holmes for the easy follow-up layup.
They are a big-time powerhouse club inside, and that concerns Duke. As Allery misses, Phillips follows. Jay Phillips, 6'8" senior. Out of Rolling Hills, California, ties it up.
Well, the way this game has started out, this game is going to be decided in the trenches. Both teams really going to the boards here early.
Duke coming into this tournament. Impressive win over Old Dominion University. Had a scare against Mississippi Valley State. Here is Johnny Dawkins on the break. And Duke has a 4-2 lead.
Rod Strickland, a tough lean-in jumper. It didn't go. The problem there was poor floor balance by DePaul. Nobody back to stop the defense. They've got to use good floor balance. Someone's got to be back defensively.
And it goes to Holmes, broken up by Phillips. Dawkins, and there's that balance you were talking about a while ago, Doug. They've got, oh, they missed the easy layup. Dawkins to follow. Amaker has it, and it'll be off of DePaul. So twice they haven't had anybody back.
Well, Tommy Amaker right that time was very casual on that layup. We see Coach Joey Meyer went in there sort of nonchalantly, missed an easy left-handed layup.
Mike Krzyzewski, the ACC Coach of the Year, the National Coach of the Year, according to UPI, is Dawkins from outside. Blocking off well is Kevin Holmes.
We saw right there a zone defense by DePaul. They don't want to play Duke man-to-man. There's no way they can match up with them, especially at the guard position.
Marty Embry has played so well in tournament play. And we're going to have a foul away from the ball. The foul is going to go on Phillips. It'll be his first. four seniors in the starting lineup. As you mentioned at the top of this broadcast, 13 different lineups, but this seems to be the best of all of those.
Well, I think the key there is not only do you have the seniors in the lineup, but Dallas Thomases, who's such a factor for this ball club, didn't go into the tank. He accepted the role and has come off the bench and likes the spotlight.
And there's a turnover. Lamone Lampley, one of those seniors, second turnover against the Blue Demons. Krzyzewski was a player at Army, later the head coach at 28 years of age. Now in his sixth year as head coach of the Blue Devils, three straight 21 seasons. Dawkins reach around by Tony Jackson batting it away as they jump into that zone again. Inside, stolen by Embry. Off it comes to Rod Strickland. He grew up in the shadows of Yankee Stadium in the Bronx. Holmes tries to put it down. Tough shot. Doesn't get it. Phyllis has it ripped away, and Tony Jackson has fouled it. You can see, we saw DePaul earlier in the year, Doug. You can see DePaul playing a lot more confidence. They have their game up about two clicks in intensity.
This is not even the same ball club that I saw early in the year. We see Dallas Thomases on the bench mentally preparing himself to come in the ball game, but they seem a step quicker, they seem livelier, and they seem more confident.
Right now, Duke with a 4-2 lead. Alley, outstanding outside shooter. Dawkins rips it down, the 6-2 senior out to Amaker. Dawkins, the all-time leading scorer. Duke traveled to the ball. So both teams having some problems mechanically in the early going. A little of the excitement of this action. As you can see, the shooting not very good. Here's the guy, a big key, Rod Strickland, averaging 14 points a game, the leading scorer, and he's going to have to handle that pressure of Amaker in his face all night long.
Yeah, he must get DePaul in their offense.
Embry on the base, drives in, Holmes. You talk about some beef, you get Embry and Holmes in there, there's not a lot of room.
Mike Krzyzewski there wanted a double dribble. He had felt that Marty Embry had already used up his dribble. Jay Billis bellied up against him. Marty Embry drove right around him baseline, dished off for the easy dunk.
Amaker, their assist man, their point guard, he makes it all start. He's the catalyst. Off to Henderson. Here's Allery. Allery's become a complete player this year, and he is fouled by Lamone Lampley. That'll be his first. Second team foul against the Blue Demons.
Here's the last DePaul basket. Marty Embry driving baseline. Henderson trying to take the charge. No go. And Kevin Holmes punctuating it with a slam dunk.
Lampley with the foul, giving the ball to Duke out of bounds. Here is Dawkins, so quick. Krzyzewski said there's only so many Johnny Dawkins. Allery nails it. He is fun to watch.
He's such a flexible player. He can score inside for you. Actually, though, he likes playing on the perimeter a little more. He likes that 15-foot jumper, and he likes to use his quickness when big people come out and contest him on the perimeter.
He's put his inside and outside game together this year. Dawkins tracks it down. And it is tough in there. Coming out of there is Lampley. Paul is playing some tough defense.
What's impressed me is they're getting back quickly on turnovers. They're not giving Duke the breaks after they force the steal.
There's Jackson out of the San Francisco area. Wide open is Embry. He lost it. Strickland saves it somehow. Nice change, and he gets it to go. And I cannot get over what a different DePaul team this is in the opening minutes of this game. Six all. They're playing like they have a purpose. We saw them earlier when they were very tentative, didn't expect anything to drop. That's not the case thus far. Harris Henderson is getting some real toughness. A sixth man a year ago, and we're going to have a foul as Lampley really pickled that one out of bounds.
Let's watch the play. Marty Embry goes up strong. He's stripped down low by Henderson. And here's Rod Strickland stepping in, using his body. A little double pumper there on Mark Allery. He gets a score, and then
the foul is on Holmes. It was Lampley that blocked it, but Holmes had committed the foul. Lampley's a fly swatter. He'll go up and he'll knock him around a lot. The third team foul against DePaul as Henderson to the line. Out of Drury, North Carolina, population of 200. Not even listed on a map, and he misses the free throw. He's a good free throw shooter, shooting 75% on the year. Henderson, a co-captain, second team all ACC. You might recall, he was the most valuable player in that preseason NIT. 7-6 Duke. Duke with a remarkable record of 34-2. The record for victories is 36 by Kentucky set in 1948. Here is Strickland on the move. Three men crash the board, but Dawkins comes up with it.
DePaul was all over the offensive board. They actually knocked the ball away from each other, going at it so aggressively.
That's that power game that concerns Krzyzewski. Coach K, as he's affectionately known. We played 5 minutes in this game. Duke leads by one. Hamilton from outside. Rebound. Home. Out it comes to Jackson. Jackson to pull up with one. Rebound. Lampley. They are crashing everything. And it goes. I think Krzyzewski thought there was some interference on that one, as one of the DePaul players looked like he had his hand up on the rim, or at least the net area.
Well, Mike Krzyzewski told us yesterday they've got to do a good job on the offensive boards. Right now, DePaul hammering them on the offensive glass. Duke has got to block out. This is a quick-leaping DePaul team.
Ball is 4 of 10 from the field. Duke 3 of 9. Turnover against the Blue Devils. 5 of them. Substitutions. Danny Ferry will be coming in for Duke. Also coming in, Billy King. We have a timeout. Duke trails by one. DePaul with a one-point lead. Joey Meyer has had a year, well, there's just been all kinds of struggles. But his team playing so much more relaxed. They're crashing the boards. It's interesting, isn't it, how things can change?
Well, he talked to us yesterday. He said, you know, everybody talks about my team's much more relaxed. He said, I'm still coaching the same way. He says, maybe they're more relaxed now because they're confident and they're winning. Maybe that has created it.
Three straight wins. Two in the tournament, one at the end of the season. It got them into the 64-team field. A one-point lead as Jackson will bring it up. DePaul has made no changes. Two substitutions for Duke. Jackson has it batted away. Strickland retrieves it.
DePaul worked a lot in practice on Tony Jackson bringing the ball up against the pressure.
The travel there.
To try to take a little pressure off of Rod Strickland. They don't feel like Rod Strickland for 40 minutes can go against Amaker. So what he wants to do is let Tony Jackson bring the ball up on occasion to try to give Rod Strickland a little bit of a rest.
Here comes Dallas Comegys, who's come into a six-man role, and he likes it. I think Mike Krzyzewski said it well. He is spotlighted. He comes in, and he's in the spotlight. He responds well to it.
They like to get him going early offensively, too. Let's watch to see if he comes in shooting.
Comegys averaging just under 14 points a game. 6'9". Junior, the only junior on this team out of the Philadelphia area. Amaker to Allery. Allery, you got a guarding from there. Look at Dawkins get up.
Oh, what a spectacular leap for Johnny Dawkins. He must have been about 40 inches off the floor that time and all in one motion finished the basket.
They retired his number this year, the third number to be retired at Duke. So number 24 will not be worn by any other Duke player.
Well, I thought it was interesting. I think they made a stipulation that he's got to graduate too, so they sort of give him a little incentive there.
There's Strickland and a beautiful pass that time from Comegys. 10-9 DePaul. Top-ranked team, Duke, 18 in a row, the ACC champions, the number one seed the entire tournament. They've had a remarkable year. Amaker from outside. Ferry tries to crash the board, following inside is King, and he's fouled by Holmes. Kevin Holmes committing his second foul, and Terrence Green now will check in for DePaul. He is a freshman guard out of Flint. He replaces Tony Jackson, and Henderson comes back in. Amaker will sit down.
Dallas Comegys that time did not block off the offensive board. He let Danny Ferry get a running start from about 18 feet out, and although he didn't get the rebound, he kept it alive, and then Billy King was able to gather it and go up strong and draw the foul. Sometimes Dallas Comegys depends a little bit too much on his physical skills, and he doesn't get his body on people. These are quick Duke leapers.
Sitting down now is Holmes with two fouls. Coming back in, Lamone Lampley. They have some flexibility and some experience in that forward wall as King misses a free throw. He is a very poor free throw shooter. Only shoots 49%. In fact, Coach K was telling us it drags the rest of his game down. It affects the rest of his play because he does not shoot well from the free throw line. However, they get the rebound. Allery brings it out. The ball by one. 12:45 left to go in this first half of play.
Johnny Dawkins now at the point here of the offense. He's playing the lead guard. Amaker out of the ball game.
Allery on the miss. And it's batted out off of DePaul. Duke will reload it. Allery was all ACC as a sophomore, did not make the first team last year, but has come back this year to have such a strong senior year, and his stock in the draft has gone up immeasurably. A lot of people feel he's a number three forward now in the draft that will come up in June. Dawkins from outside. He is fouled. Foul will go on Rod Strickland. Strickland committing his first 15 foul against DePaul.
That's the coach's nightmare right there, fouling a jump shooter. You want to get a hand in a jump shooter's face, but a guy shooting an 18-footer never deserves to shoot a free throw. And I'm sure Joey Meyer telling Rod Strickland, get your hand in his face, don't foul him.
This guy has no area of weakness. He can do it all. Inside, outside, outstanding leaper. First team All-American, won the Naismith Award as the National Player of the Year. MVP in the ACC tourney. There's nothing he hasn't accomplished this year.
You know, the one thing that Coach Krzyzewski said yesterday impressed me more than anything about Johnny Dawkins, he said he's improved every year. That tells me the kid is hungry. He's not sitting on his press clipping. He wants to get better.
He has 6 points. Duke now with a one-point lead. Strickland into Embry. Marty Embry turned around and he walked with it. That will be 5 turnovers. Embry's coming off of a very strong game. He had 19 points and 11 rebounds in that win over Oklahoma, averaging 12 points, 11 rebounds in the 2 tournament games.
Well, Duke's swarming down there in a double-up defense. You got to kick that ball out when you feel a double team. DePaul must do a better job spotting up to give him a pass.
Henderson inside. Dawkins tips it back to the co-captain. And it won't go again. And Embry brings it out, and he's fouled. Foul will go on Billy King. That is his first. Second team foul. Duke not shooting well as far as statistics are concerned. They've had their opportunities.
Well, Lamone Lampley and Dallas Comegys is changing a lot of shots in there. They're getting their hands up. The Duke players going up to take the shots, and at the last moment, they're having to alter their shots in the air. As a result, they're getting poor shots at it.
Phyllis comes in. Allery will catch a breather at the 11:43 mark. Duke is 5 of 15 from the field. And they're just a superb shooting ball club coming into this game. There is Embry. That's a different Embry. He was not even confident that ball was even going to be close to going in the hole earlier this season. Winning salves a lot of wounds.
Doesn't it?
Ball by one. Good defense by Terrence Green. Here is Ferry, the freshman who's going to be a real impact player in the years to come, and he had a tough shot.
Not only used one pump fake there, he used 2 pump fakes to finally get Lamone Lampley in the air, a little lean in. That's a tough shot when you don't use a backboard, but it didn't give him much problem.
Up it comes to Comegys. He draws a crowd. It's a difficult shot at best. Ferry brings it down, the 6'10 freshman. Duke with a one-point lead. Dawkins on the move. Had it stripped. And it's going to be off of Dawkins. Boy, it is tough when you duck inside on this game. Amaker will come back in now. Leaving the ball game will be King. So Duke has given every one of their players a blow in the early part of this game. On the other hand, the ball has pretty much gone to the same lineup except for Comegys and Green. They have alternated Lamone Lampley on a couple of occasions. Strickland takes it inside, and he's fouled by Amaker. That was a big move by Strickland, the freshman, showing the junior something.
Well, he's showing a lot of confidence, taking the ball to the basket. Tommy Amaker, one of the top defensive players in the country. Good quickness there. Amaker trying to come from behind, picks up the foul. And DePaul will get a chance to inbound the ball underneath their own basket.
Strickland may have impacted his program as much as any freshman in the country. He has really given this DePaul team some stability at that point guard spot. And now he's with the ball. Played well beyond his experience. Pass baseline, Lampley. Bad angle, but he got it. He was almost out of sight to shoot that one.
Tough fade away jump shot, but again, Marty Embry hand way above the basket, waiting to tap that in case the shot was missed. Both of these teams are all over the offensive backboard.
We've had 8 lead changes. DePaul with the advantage right now, and Terrence Green has committed the foul. Let's go back to that last difficult shot we were talking about.
Well, let's watch the jumper. He's behind the basket, but watch Marty Embry's hand. Watch this. The shot goes up. Let's watch Marty Embry. He's waiting right there, and he pulls his hand away at the last moment to keep from getting an offensive goaltending.
That shot looked like one you'd practice when you had nothing else to do out in the gym. As Allery comes back in, very difficult shot. Perry comes out of the ball game. Dawkins at the line. Dawkins an 81% free throw shooter.
Duke as a team, a very good free throw shooting team. They're shooting over 71%. On the other hand, DePaul, a very poor free throw shooting team, 61%.
DePaul has not been at the free throw line yet as Embry brings it down. On the other hand, Duke is 50%, 4 of 8 from the line. 14 apiece. Inside 10 minutes to go in this first half. And it goes to Comiskey's lean in and a blocking foul. It'll go against Phyllis. His second. Fourth team foul now against Duke as Tony Jackson comes back in. Green will lead. Tony Jackson is one of those seniors who is just battling, losing so much confidence, shooting early in the year about 30-some percent. He's now been able to move that average up to 43%. And as you mentioned, before the game's over, he may have to relieve Strickland of bringing the ball up.
They want him to be able, they worked on it all week. They'd like for him to work maybe a little bit against Johnny Dawkins, but that's no real treat either because both these players are outstanding defensive players. Dallas Comiskey's showing the Achilles heel of this DePaul ball club. That's their free throw shooting.
Well, they missed their first chance. Comiskey's a 64% free throw shooter. The shot looks good. Looks like it should go. It does the second time. 9 minutes, 48 seconds left to be played in this first half. DePaul, they're not awed by Duke.
And to give you a live score update from the Midwest, Kansas leading Michigan State 27-18, Bill, midway through the first half.
Well, Chris, Michigan State in that 2-3 defense, giving up some inside stuff now. Greg Dreiling hustling to clear out for an alley-oop to Calvin Thompson.
That
pretty looking play.
Yes, that looked easy. They've hit 12 out of 16 from the floor. The Jayhawks, they have a 9-point lead. Let's go back now to the Meadowlands and Duke and DePaul.
DePaul with a 1-point lead, 15-14. You speculate a little bit, Doug Collins, and you wonder if Duke will eventually go to a zone because, as you mentioned, DePaul's not a good shooting ball club. They prefer to play against the man. Mike Krzyzewski comes from the Bob Knight School. Bob does not like to play the zone, but Coach K will.
Yes, he will, and he'll do it. He told us yesterday he'll do it in stretches just to check to see how DePaul's shooting the ball outside, especially if the trend continues and DePaul continues to get the ball to their inside people who are doing the damage right now.
DePaul jumping into the zone themselves. Amaker from outside. Duke is not hitting that outside shot, and a pushing foul inside. It's going to go against Duke. That will be the third foul on Billis, so they've got to get him out of there. Jay Billis committing his third, 15 foul against Duke as Ferry comes back in. So the first man to get into foul difficulty with still 9.5 minutes to go in the first half.
They lose a little toughness right now. Jay Billis gives them a little bit of that strength around the basket. Danny Ferry, more of a finesse player. Who's going to pick up the slack now on the inside? It's going to have to probably be at Mark Allery.
Strickland having a tough time as Dawkins playing the good defense. Comiskey's out of control. Nope. Yep, it's going to be the charge. You could see that one coming. Dallas never, ever puts the ball on the floor. He doesn't handle it at all, and that time he was obviously in an area he's not familiar with.
Well, when you play against a team like Duke that plays such outstanding team defense, you always have to be aware of someone stepping in on you. You've got to pull up at the free throw line, shoot that little jumper. That's Dallas Comiskey's forte anyway. He doesn't need to take it all the way to the basket.
Charging foul. This is the 17th foul now against DePaul. Dawkins from outside. Lampley jumped in his face. Made no difference as the All-American nails it. 9 points for Dawkins, a 1-point lead now for Duke. 10 lead changes thus far, with 8:49 left to go in the first half. Inside Embry, everybody hitting the deck, especially Ferry, who tried to draw the foul, and the officials would have nothing of it, and Embry now with 6 points.
Well, great play there by Marty Embry. Again, just overpowering Danny Ferry inside.
Strickland almost has a steal. Pushing them a long ways out with this zone, aren't they?
They really are. They're not getting the ball inside. They've become a perimeter-oriented team. Johnny Dawkins looking to snipe away from the outside.
Strickland causing some difficulty in that wing area. There's the skip pass against the zone. Amaker will skip it back to Henderson. And Henderson gets center. And his best season by far, now with 3 points. 1-point lead for the Duke Blue Devils. DePaul getting the better of it in the field goal department.
Let's see if the ball can get the ball inside again. It's been good to him. Rod Strickland dribbled himself into a little bit of a problem here.
Perry going for the steal on Embry. Rod Strickland pull up. That was a tough shot. Did he stop on a dime?
Oh, he did. And his momentum went vertical rather than going horizontal, Gary. If he had gone horizontal, he'd have drawn an offensive foul. He just exploded in the air and went straight up to avoid the foul.
He's had some flashes of brilliance. A first-year man. 19-18, DePaul.
Amaker has been cold here early in the game, shooting from the top of the circle. Looks a little bit tentative now, not wanting to take the shot.
They have a foul as Henderson ducking inside. Committing that foul is going to be Embry. Marty Embry committing the foul, and on the baseline now. Wait a minute. They're going to be shooting free throws as Henderson will have a one and one. Henderson, as we said, a good free throw shooter. All these guys are, other than King and Billis, who struggle a little bit. And that did not look good.
That didn't even look close right there. David Henderson threw up a brick.
They are now 4 of 9 from the line. Strickland taking Amaker inside. And we're going to have a foul as Strickland right now is giving Amaker all he can handle.
He's giving him all he can handle. He's also giving him no respect. He's driving the ball right to where he wants to take it and just jumping up and using his athletic ability to either score or get to the free throw line. Tommy Amaker rubbing his chin right now, wondering how he got the worst of that and still committed the foul.
That's the second foul on Amaker. He will continually put the pressure on you defensively. And right now, Rod Strickland has not backed off at all. Missing the free throw. Strickland, 69% free throw shooter. They are 1 of 3 now as the team, as for the first time now, Quinn Snyder will check in, a freshman out of Mercer Island, Washington. Amaker will lead. Snyder, a highly recruited player out of the Great Northwest, as Strickland's second shot looks bad. Jackson on the retrieve. Well, you can't hit the free throws, get the rebound, and hit a field goal.
Well, you want to talk about coach's nightmares, add that one. You can throw in fouling a jump shooter, and how about giving up a rebound off a missed free throw for a jump shot? Those will turn coach's hair gray in a hurry or either force you to lose it.
Biggest lead of the game for the Blue Demons. Here is Snyder, and he shot that one with Lamone Lampley blocking the goal. I mean, he was up above him when he released the ball.
Did anyone tell him that this is an NCAA tournament game and he's a freshman? First time he touches the ball, he didn't even break a sweat yet, and he's let it go and draw nothing but net.
You know, Coach K said he reminds him of you.
Well, he has no conscience. That's a pretty good comparison.
That'll be off of DePaul. 7 turnovers. As coming into the game will be King again for Duke. Henderson will sit down. 6:19 to go in the first half. Upset-minded DePaul with a one-point lead. Joey Meyer working the officials. He thought Comegys was fouled on that last play, or at least the ball was off of Duke. And there is Strickland on the steal. He took it away from the All-American and Snyder. That'll be a two-shot foul, an intentional foul.
Rod Strickland, great hands on the defense. They're going to rule an intentional foul. Let's watch the play here. Rod Strickland, great hands to strip the ball loose. He's going to use the ball, use the floor now to use his speed. There's a reach in right there in the grab to prevent the layup. So it'll be a two-shot foul for Rod Strickland.
You don't take the ball away from Johnny Dawkins very often. Somebody forgot to tell Strickland.
Boy, he's playing a great ball game right now. And, you know, the tempo of this game favors DePaul right now. Duke, about the first 2 minutes of the ball game, got out. They got a couple steals. They got out running, Gary. But DePaul has adjusted. Their zone has been effective. They forced them on the perimeter, and they've got back very well defensively.
Hawkins, by the way, has 4 of Duke's 6 turnovers. Strickland, after missing two, now has hit one. That one didn't look good. Snyder comes down with it, and Strickland fouled it.
There's a freshman mistake right there. Missed the free throw and went in and stuck his hand and got caught being in the cookie jar by the official there and picked up the foul.
So that will put him in a one-on-one situation. Strickland committing his second foul. Terrence Green will come in. Strickland will sit down. Green was an outstanding football player. In fact, he had an opportunity to play major college football, and his junior year was voted the best football player in the Detroit area. And Snyder now with a 1-1. Embry brings it down. And when he brings it down, just clear out.
Missed free throws have really been a story of this first half. Both teams having an opportunity to capitalize on the free throw line, and either team able to do it.
Tomagy's long ways out. That was pretty.
North Philadelphia is only about an hour and a half away from here, so he feels at home right now. He was in another zip car area code on that jump shot.
He was in Philadelphia, and he shot it. Here's Allery, and he can't get it. Terrence Green will retrieve it, and Quinn Snyder ties him up. And the alternating help ball will go to DePaul. That was a quick jump ball. Anyway, the Blue Demons will have the basketball. They have a four-point lead. Joey Meyer's team, they were the talk of Greensboro, and you can see why, because they are playing like they deserve to be in this tournament long before anybody else thought they were. Stockton converts at the other end.
Right now, there's going to be a problem with DePaul. Terrence Green having to handle the ball. They need to get it back to Tony Jackson. Dawkins should really be able to force the pressure here against the freshman Terrence Green, who's not a good ball handler.
And as you talk, Strickland is getting up and getting ready to come back in the ball game. They can't afford to have him out of there very long. Lampley to Tomagy's, and he pushed off to get open. That was Tomagy's committing his second personal foul. Strickland comes in. Green will lead. We're going to have a break. Well, I guess we're going to hold it right here. The 4:59 now left in this first half. Duke, 4 of 10 from the free throw line, have missed the front end of 3 1-and-1s. And going to the line now will be Allery, as Holmes will come back in for DePaul. Tomagy's with that second foul will sit down. Allery out of Brophy Prep, Scottsdale, Arizona. The thing that Krzyzewski said about him, he's learned to box and slug. In other words, he can finesse it, or he can play the power game as well.
Well, he had to make the transition. Last year, he was more of an inside player. This year, he's been able to get back outside a little bit because of Jay Billis playing so well and with the addition of Danny Ferry. But you like his versatility. You get a bigger, slower player on him, he'll take it to the hoop. You get a quicker player on him, he'll post him up.
He can tie it up with this free throw and does. So now we're going to take that break. It's all even at 24. 4 minutes, 59 seconds to go, and Joey Meyer's team is hanging tough. This reminder, at the conclusion of every CBS Sports NCAA tournament broadcast, we'll be selecting a Chevrolet Most Valuable Player from each team, and Chevrolet donates a $1,000 scholarship to the general scholarship fund of each school to further assist qualified students in all chosen academic fields. I would think, Doug, the longer DePaul stays in this game, the more confidence they're going
to
get.
The tempo is to their liking right now. It's a low-scoring ball game. Duke is not getting easy shots. DePaul has been able to get the ball inside. Free throw shooting has been a factor. DePaul has not been able to take advantage of their opportunities.
Well, and Duke is 6 of 12. DePaul is 2 of 6 from the free throw line. You expect that of DePaul, but not Duke.
Free throw shooting, Gary, I can't tell you enough how important it is in the tournament ball games. You've got to be able to step up the line and knock them in.
Jackson taking some of the pressure is fouled by Snyder. That'll be Quinn Snyder's second. So as we were talking, they'd like to have Jackson take some of that energy drain himself. Allow Strickland to play off the ball, and he did a good job that time down the floor.
He drove the ball right to the free throw line against Quinn Snyder. Quinn had pretty good position, but at the last moment tried to block the shot. Now Tony Jackson will step to the free throw line. He told me before the game, he said, I want you to call me Big Daddy tonight. He said, that's my new nickname, Big Daddy.
If he keeps hitting free throws like that, you got to call him what he wants, right?
That's right.
He dead-centered that one. He's been a good free throw shooter in the final minutes of every game. He has good rotation on the ball and gets them both. 4 points for Jackson, a two-point lead for DePaul. Rebound, Dawkins. He'll put it right back up and in. Oh, he's fun to watch.
That's his third basket on the offensive boards. He slipped in and got 6 points as a 6'3 guard, slashing to the boards. The guard's got to step back into that zone and box him out.
13 points for Johnny Dawkins. Holmes ducks in. Dead center. I'm telling you, they were not hitting those shots earlier in the year.
You know, when you look at the DePaul front line, you want to talk a word, you talk power. The bodies on Embry and Holmes, big, powerful players that can take the bump and finish the shot.
You know, it's been said they're good athletes, maybe not with great basketball skills, but their skills are certainly coming to the forefront tonight. There's another turnover as now Amaker coming in, and and Henderson also coming in.
Let's watch Johnny Dawkins on the offensive board. The shot goes up. DePaul's in his zone. Here comes Dawkins right down the middle. A guard has got to step in there, Gary, and get his body. You can't let a leaper like Johnny Dawkins get a flying start, or he'll kill you on the offensive board.
Mike Swanson, our statistician, indicating Dawkins is a leading rebounder with six to go with those 13 points. There's Holmes, and he tries to save it, cannot. So Duke has a chance to tie it up on this trip down the floor. 10 turnovers against the ball. We've had 13 lead changes and six ties thus far. With 3:40 left to go in the first half. Amaker still trying to hit that outside shot. It's just not there. Here comes Strickland. Strickland in midair, and he gave it to Emory, who traveled. He was in trouble and put his big man in a difficult situation.
Got hung in the air at the last moment. Found only Marty Embry. He had to catch the ball and put it on the floor. You don't want to give it to the big man, but the big thing as a guard, pull up, keep yourself on the floor. If the defense drops off, you take a little jump shot.
Good ball movement this time. Henderson takes it in. It's tied up at 28. The thing about Strickland, he's got to learn, is what Dawkins does. Dawkins lets the game come to him. Strickland sometimes tries to force it, and it's not there.
That's just inexperience coming to the front right there. You get a little excited. You get into an up-tempo game. What you've always been great at, running the ball up the floor, all of a sudden you get a little carried away, and that's what happened to Rod Strickland. But his teammates will calm him down. They'll go and let him know, just keep it under control. We're right here in this ball game. It's a tie basketball game, and we've got the tempo to our liking.
Henderson committing the foul, sending to the line Kevin Holmes. We talk about Holmes and his athletic ability. High jump, 6'11" in high school. Long jump, 23 feet. Played on a basketball team with Brett Saberhagen, the Cy Young Award winner for the Royals. But his basketball skills at the free throw line deserted.
50% free throw shooter on the season.
28 apiece. Inside, 3 minutes to go in the first half. Inside, nice move by Allery. He is fouled. Nice change to the left hand that time by the senior. Basket will count.
Nice entry pass to Allery. The ball's knocked loose, but look at him shift the ball to his left hand, kiss it off the glass, and have the opportunity for the three-point play. Here's the difference in a player like Mark Allery. He's a good free throw shooter. He'll probably cash in on this three-point opportunity.
Holmes committed the foul, his third, so he has to leave. Homagies will come back in. Allery with a chance for a three-point play. His maturity, in the estimation of Krzyzewski, really has made him understand who he is. Got that solid confidence in what he can do, and he just nails the three-point play, and he gives Duke a three-point lead. Biggest lead of the game for Duke. DePaul has led by as many as three in this first half. Pressure. Here comes Dawkins. All of a sudden, the top-ranked team in the country has made a spurt.
That play was made by Tommy Amaker. Everybody's going to look at the box score and see steal and dunk by Johnny Dawkins. Tommy Amaker forced Strickland to pick up the dribble and to make a bad pass.
You get the feeling it's a very crucial stage of the game for DePaul. The boys just a little shaky right now, and there's another turnover. Up it comes to Dawkins, and Ramon Lampley swatted it away. Coming in will be King. Amaker will leave, and I think Joey Meyer wants a timeout. That's a very good timeout by the second-year coach. This game is getting away from him. Duke, who can quickly strike, doing exactly that, and with 2:01 to go in this first half, they bumped it up to a 33-28 lead. Let's go back now on this play by Johnny Dawkins. Show you why he is an All-American.
We're going to see the play. David Henderson there with the steal. He's going to look up court, and he spots Johnny Dawkins. He has the little jumper, but he wants to take it inside. The shot is blocked there by Lamone Lampley. But two straight opportunities down the floor for DePaul were taken away by the relentless defense of Duke. Gary, as we talked about on the top of the ball game, Duke prides itself in its defense. Their defense forces them to get into the running game. And that's the sign of a great ball club.
I thought it was interesting on that trip down the floor. I thought we were going to show the stuff shot, but he was pointing to his teammate, talking to him as they went down the floor, really communicating.
A lot of times, you don't see what happens off the ball. A kid like Tommy Amaker, let's watch Tommy Amaker, the ball pressure he puts on Rod Strickland. Look at him. He's forced him to pick up his dribble. He's all over him, and boom, here comes Johnny Dawkins from the weak side. Let's watch the young man explode into the air and point to his teammates and say, guys, we got him on the run now. Let's keep it going this last 2:01 of the first half.
He is such a quick leaper, Doug. I think you distinguish a lot of between leapers and quick leapers. I would put him in that quick category.
He is, and he's also a guy who can go up once and come back down and strike you again, almost like a snake that can just jump out and bite you. You talk about guys who are slow jumpers. They have to gather themselves. Johnny Dawkins just explodes.
You see how effective they've been on points off the turnover. 33-28 Duke. As they've made a move here in the waning 3 minutes of this first half. Paul with a very strategic timeout, trying to gather their poise back, get back into what they were doing so well earlier. As Embry pass it out, and then they say Ferry touched it last, so DePaul will have it. Boy, they talk about the end of the first half and the start of the second, how it can just destroy you. And right now, Duke is really trying to put some distance between themselves and DePaul team.
It's that 5 minutes at the end of the first half and the 5 minutes to start the second half.
Strickland. Well, that'll negate some of it. He cuts it to three. 9 points for Rod Strickland.
That is one of those baskets that sort of stops the bleeding. That's a momentum stopper right there. And Rod Strickland took it in his own hands as a freshman to be the one to take the shot.
Dawkins off to Henderson. He's wide open. Can't get it. Allery. Nice follow by Allery. See why they love this guy. He has 9 points and gives Duke the 5-point lead.
And his last two baskets have been with the left hand.
Strickland having a tough time with Dawkins. That's a long ways out, but Lampley gets it. I would think that might be a little beyond what Joey Meyer feels is his range, but he got it anyway. That's one of those what? No, great shot.
That's right. Joey's over there telling his team now, we got 59 seconds here. If we get a good stretch of defense, we'll get the ball back, maybe have an opportunity to cut this to a 1-point game before we go in at halftime.
You see the time left in the first half.
Going man-to-man here, Gary, man-to-man defense.
And Strickland giving Dawkins some difficulty, and it's going to be off of Dawkins. Strickland, the senior and freshman going after each other, and now Dawkins.
I think he's going to change his call. He's going to call that it's Duke basketball.
Yes, he did. He's called it the other way now. He called it one way. And rescinded it. Let's see if we can pick it up here.
Strickland knocks the ball loose. They dive for it. And there the ball goes off Rod Strickland. It was off Rod Strickland. Good call there by the official, Dick Paparo, to make sure he gets that job correct, or that call correctly.
I thought he might have thrown it off of Dawkins' back.
Well, I thought it just fell out of his hands there. I think he was trying to, but I think his momentum carried him forward, Gary. I don't know whether he ever got it done or not. And now they're going to be able to use the clock the rest of the half.
Last shot of this first half. Duke with a 3-point lead. You see King over there having a conversation with Krzyzewski. The corner is Henderson. Dead center. Up the floor. Tomagies. He is going to be called for charging. That's twice. He's tried to put the ball on the floor, and he cannot do it. That's his third foul. He just was a little shaky, lost a little bit of his confidence. He put it on the floor, and at 6'9", he can't control it that well.
It looked to me like he was looking up at the clock trying to see how much time there was. He didn't know whether to let it go from half court or whether he had enough time. He decided to put it on the floor. Never really saw where the defensive man was at.
The Tomagies and Holmes each have 3 fouls in this first half. 5-point lead for Duke with 2 seconds. Perry will try to get one underway, and that would not have counted had it gone, according to referee Jim Bain. So we come to the halfway point for the semifinal game in the East Regional. The score at halftime, Duke 37, DePaul 32. CBS Sports coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship. We'll continue after this message and a word from your local station.
Tonight's East Regional semifinal game is sponsored by Pontiac, America's road car company. Pontiac, we build excitement.
Country, the Kansas Jayhawks. They have a very rich basketball tradition. Gary Paul Gates went out to Kansas to retrace those roots. And before Duke opened it up at the end to take this five-point lead. As you analyze this first half, Duke has been putting the ball up a lot more than DeVall.
Well, they got 12 more opportunities at the field, although they didn't shoot as high a percentage, Gary. But I thought the key in the first half was the defense. We see the field goals there. DePaul shot a great percentage, 14 for 22. Duke, 15 for 34.
Now, the free throw department, we knew DePaul was not a good free throw shooting team, but Duke was surprising. They missed three front ends of 1-1.
Only 7 for 13. They really had an opportunity at the free throw line to put some distance between them and DePaul, but they didn't get it done.
Doug, if you analyze statistically this first half, the difference is in points off turnovers.
Well, we knew that was Duke's strength coming in. Could they be able to get out in the open floor and create things? Tommy Amaker did a great job forcing a couple turnovers. Johnny Dawkins on the receiving ends of the pass. Tommy Amaker putting great pressure on the basketball. Johnny Dawkins in the lower part of our circle. He's going to come off the ball, a great steal. And these are plays like this that Johnny Dawkins made in the first half to put this Duke team in the lead.
Coming into this game, Amaker, along with Dawkins, between them, had 108 steals, to give you an idea how effective they are.
Well, they play great team defense together. They know where each other are on the floor at all times.
And so DePaul, a little bit of foul difficulty as they have Holmes and Kamajis with three each. CBS Sports coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship will continue after this message and a word from your local station.
Tonight's East Regional semifinal game is sponsored by Miller Lite. For great taste, there's only one light beer. Rolaids, for acid indigestion or heartburn, Rolaids spells relief. And by Today's Chevrolet, who invites you to live the style, performance, and fun of Chevrolet in 86.
Ready to begin the second half. Duke closed the half with a 9-4 run. As an end result, they lead by five. You look at the scoring. Dawkins, not only the leading scorer, but the leading rebounder in the game. Strickland with 9 points. Interesting, Amaker in that first half was 0 for 5 from the field. We mentioned that Kamajis and Holmes are in foul trouble. We should also mention that Billis has 3 personal fouls for Duke.
Also for Duke, David Henderson with only 1 foul. Dawkins and Ellery, neither one of them picked up a personal foul in the first half. And Gary, I think we talked about keys at the top of the ball game. We talked about foul trouble for Duke. They've stayed out of it. They've actually won the battle of the boards by 5, and they've done a nice job forcing turnovers. DePaul, 14 turnovers in the first half.
And it kind of snuck up on you, didn't it? Early it looked like DePaul was handling it well. Not all of a sudden it started to mount, and then that 9-4 run, and that's where we are right now. Here is Dawkins, and as he moves, he walks with it. So DePaul will have it. That's 9 turnovers against the Blue Devils.
Well, Johnny Dawkins has committed. That's his 5th turnover of the ball game. So he has been a little lax with the basketball. That's something you don't normally see from him. But he is so quick. The officials sometimes have to really watch him. He makes that first quick, powerful step. He gets called for walking an awful lot.
Here is Strickland, who led DePaul in scoring in the first half. Goes baseline to Lampley. Rebound tipped out. Holmes off to Tony Jackson. Jackson can't get it to go. Lampley tries to keep it alive, and the power game underway, and a foul will go on Holmes, and that's his 4th. They had everything set up. They had inside position. They had crack after crack at the basket, and they end up with a very costly foul.
Joey Meyer is slow going to his bench right now. He's making a decision what he's going to do with Kevin Holmes. Right now he's elected to keep him in the basketball game.
Kamajis will come in. Now Dallas will be playing with 3 fouls as they'll get Holmes out of there, hopefully, before he commits his 5th. There's Dawkins with Jackson up against him. Didn't even bother the All-American.
Oh, what a tough shot. A left-handed player going to his right, a little fadeaway off a bump. And Gary, you know left-handers. Being a lefty, you can't go to your right, but he can.
You trying to compare me to Dawkins? Give me a break. 39-32. Ball still looking for their first points in the second half. Out it comes to Dawkins. Back is Jackson. Dawkins takes it in. Rebound, Allery. And they continue the spurt now. They've outscored them 13-4. 9-4th into the half and added 4 more of their advantage. And the top-ranked team playing very well.
They need a good shot this time down the floor. 2 forced shots.
going to be a foul on Billis, and that's his fourth. Billis committing the foul. Prodigies will come in. Holmes will sit down with four fouls. So Billis also in real foul difficulty. That first half, Holmes only played 9 minutes because of all the foul difficulty, and Billis likewise had only 9 minutes. So both those guys have been getting a lot of bench time due to foul difficulty. Here's Kamaji's tough shot, rebound Henderson, and he's fouled by Lamone Lampley. The ball is picking him up in bunches right now. That's the second on the 6'11" senior.
Lamone Lampley is on the boards. He's in pretty good position. But watch what happens here, Gary. Henderson uses his lower body and bumps him out of the play. And then over the top, Lamone Lampley with the foul. There's where you use the body strength right there. David Henderson has nice, strong legs. He just bumped Lamone Lampley with the body, got him out of position.
Lampley leaves. Terrence Green comes in. DePaul is 0 for 4 in the second half from the field. Duke 2 for 3. That's why Henderson's so tough. He's a tough kid physically, mentally, and he just out-positioned us. Here's Dawkins again. Dawkins continues to lead this onslaught with 19 points. 43-32, and DePaul's in danger getting blown out of this one as Joey Meyer asks for a timeout. Two timeouts left for DePaul. Duke is on the roll. They are playing like you'd expect the top-ranked team in the country to play.
Live in New York, let's get you up to date on the action out in Kansas City, Midwest Regional. Kansas and Michigan State having just started the second half, Jayhawks in front by five. Now a reminder, 12:30 Eastern time tonight, Cleveland State against Navy. If you're going to stay up and watch that game, I recommend you look away or turn around because we're going to show the rest of the audience that score from earlier tonight. Cleveland State and Navy, you'll see it 12:30 tonight Eastern time on tape delay. Right now, let's go back to Duke and DePaul, East Regional action at the Meadowlands.
Duke has a 15-4 run on DePaul. It all started with 3 minutes remaining in the first half. They build it in the first 2 minutes of the second half to a 43-32 advantage. DePaul has not scored, and you can see no points, of course, coming from the field as they're 0 for 4. They need a basket, and they need it in the worst way. Green and the Kamaji's. And as you said earlier, that'll stop the bleeding a little bit.
That's a nice set play there. Dallas Kamaji's actually set the screen, forced the defense to help out, and then he rolled back to the ball. Let's keep our eye here on Johnny Dawkins because they're playing man-to-man defense. Speaking of DePaul,
are you surprised they're in a man?
Yes, I am, because there's no way that Johnny Dawkins being matched up against. Terrence Green is trying to force him.
Look at this. Henderson got the back door almost unimpeded to the basket until the last instant. It'll be off of DePaul, and they just had a mix-up defensively.
Well, it's so tough right now to try to catch up if you're DePaul because you don't want to go man-to-man against Johnny Dawkins, but if you go zone, then you start getting very stagnant, and you start getting up outside jumpers, and then offensive rebound.
Powerful move by Allery, and he's fouled by Tony Jackson. Look at the shoulders on Allery. Jackson committing his second foul, third team foul against DePaul. Well, you have been very effective with the zone. You go to the man. I guess he felt maybe it'd shake him up a little bit, but it's kind of backfired on him.
Well, they have not come out to start this half with the same kind of zest they started the ball game. They're a little down right now. They need to climb back in the game.
Or that will put them down even farther. 45-34. 21 points for Dawkins.
Well, we talk about spectacular players. You can put Johnny Dawkins in the class of everyone in the country. He is an exciting basketball player for this Duke Blue Devil team.
Jackson gets it off to Kamaji's, and Dallas now has hit two in a row. He gets that shot up so high, it'd be so hard to block it at 6 foot nine. 45-36 Duke. They remain in the man defense. Here's Billis playing with four fouls. He's only going to have three on the screen, but he has four. Here he is on the baseline. Inside, again, Embry rips it down.
That was a nice defensive sequence there by DePaul. They forced a tough shot, and then they got up on the boards nicely to get no second shots. Let's see if they can keep it going to Kamaji's.
Kamaji's, three straight field goals. He's trying to bring him back. He's got all the scoring for DePaul in the second half, and he's cut it to seven.
Gary, this is the man that worried Mike Krzyzewski. He said yesterday, I'm concerned about Dallas Kamaji's off the bench. Three straight hoops to bring him back.
He likes that spotlight. Here's Henderson. Kamaji's in his face. Henderson to follow, and he's fouled by Tony Jackson. That's three on Jackson. as Ferry will come back into the ballgame for Duke. Domagy's not only scoring, but you see him yelling at his teammates on defense, trying to encourage him. There's always been a thought that Domagy's could be of superstar status, but you never know which curtain's going to go up on his play.
I think the one thing that really holds Dallas back is he lets his offense dictate too much of his game. If he's not playing off well offensively, he doesn't play well in the other facet of the game either.
That's going to be a foul on Henderson, who looked like he had a sure thing inside, instead commits his second personal foul. That's a good point, Doug. And you know, we were talking about King earlier. When he misses free throws, it affects the rest of his game. And Dallas, if he's not going well offensively, forget the defense.
Well, you know, he's got too many skills to allow that to happen. First of all, he can rebound, he can block shots, he can set screens and create. He can always be a force offensively because teams will respect him. If you're not shooting well, do something else to help your team.
15:41 left in this one. 7-point lead for Duke. The ball trying to climb back into it. Tony Jackson changed his shot and nailed it. They've hit four in a row now after missing four to start the second half. They're within five. I think earlier in the year, DePaul might have folded the way things were going.
I agree with you, and you got to give Comagies a lot of credit. He took it on his shoulders. He got him going with three straight hoops. Now, look at the level of their defense start to crank up a notch.
And Jim Bain has spotted a foul on Terrence Green. Substitution coming back into the ballgame will be Billy King. That was a second foul on Green. Five team fouls against DePaul. There's Comagies, 9 points. Duke with four. It's interesting how some guys who come off the bench and be so much more effective than as a starter.
Well, I think as a coach, you have to plant that seed in their mind about, hey, we need you off the bench. You're our man. If we don't have you coming off the bench, nobody can score for us.
There's some bench points. It's Ferry able to nail that one. Back to a 7-point lead. Manny Ferry with 4 points. Inside 15 minutes to go. Embry doesn't get it to go. Dawkins comes out of there in a hurry. The time the ball got back very effectively, made him pull it back out. 7 rebounds for Dawkins. He just does it all. He's the first player in ACC history to have 2,000 points, 500 assists, and 500 rebounds. And we're going to have a foul inside. Allery hits the deck, and the foul will go against the ball, and it will go against Embry, his second. 16 fouls.
Mark Allery with excellent inside position. Look at him use his lower body again. Gary, there's a difference right there. He goes up and he hangs in the air. He gets two players to commit themselves. He brings the ball back down, then he powers it at them and forces them to foul him. He never goes away from contact. But when you're a good free throw shooter and you get the ball inside, make people pay, make them foul you.
Allery possibly overshadowed a little bit by Dawkins, but the people who know feel he has a very fine career ahead of him in the pros. Up to an 8-point lead now for Duke. Paul has already committed 16 fouls and only 5.5 minutes have been played in the second half. Duke with two. 49-40. As the full court pressure now by the Blue Devils. Here's Green trying to take some of that wear and tear off of Rod Strickland as he breaks it off the floor.
Where you can see Johnny Dawkins just chasing him out too, trying to steal the ball from him.
Green does not get it to drop, and Duke tips it out of bounds. Terrence Green has just struggled shooting all year long, shooting only 38%.
Defensively on that possession, Johnny Dawkins was just stalking Terrence Green. He was like digging the hand in, waiting for that moment to go for that steal. Terrence Green must protect the basketball. Also for the double team when they like to run and jump you from behind after they force you to spin on the dribble.
Well, if you don't have Dawkins, you have Amaker. There's no deal either way, right? Strickland, quick shot. He didn't have his body squared, but he was able to hit it anyway. 11 points for the freshman. 49-42. DePaul is kind of determinedly staying in here when it looked like it might become a real disaster in the start of the second half for him.
They're also showing 3-2 zone on this possession, trying to force now maybe a little bit outside shooting, especially with the foul problem.
Dawkins is short. Allery will have it, and they'll set it up again. Allery, their leading rebounder.
Gary, right now with 16 fouls, they don't want to put Duke on the line now with 13 minutes to go in the game. I think right now they're trying to stay away from the fouls. If Duke's going to hit a shot, make him hit it from outside.
Allery inside. That was a fine pass by Ferry, a bullet pass. 51-42. turns in this game, and we're going to have a
ball turned over.
There's an offensive foul there against Tony Jackson. They ruled that he pushed off against Billy King. Billy King doing a nice job denying him the basketball, Gary. Out of frustration, Tony Jackson took the off arm and just pushed off.
And that's another foul difficulty for DePaul. That is his fourth. Both he and Holmes now on the bench with four fouls.
With Duke being in the bonus now, they're shooting 1-1. So on a foul committed like that, when it's not a player control, they're going to come down and shoot 1-1. But Billy King is not the man you want on the line if you're Mike Krzyzewski. He's by far their poorest free throw shooter at 48%.
He still feels, though, this guy's your most improved player, even though free throws have deserted him. And he had one player stand up and applaud him, one of his Duke teammates, after he hit that free throw.
I thought Mike Krzyzewski said something interesting there. He says, don't celebrate, make the next one. Don't be happy. You know, you made one. Don't be satisfied. Make them both.
Does not get the second one. Comagies does get the rebound. 62-42. Duke with the lead. 13 minutes left in this game.
If they get the ball to Comagies, he's got the hot hand right now.
Dallas Watson tries to go low to Embry. Lampley lost it to Allery. Breakaway to Dawkins. 23 points for Johnny Dawkins. Number two all-time leading scorer in the ACC. Biggest lead of the game now for the Blue Devils.
Look at the defensive pressure. Forcing him to put the ball up and then swarming and then no passing lanes.
Nothing open. Now they get it to Dallas and he put it on the floor and as he goes in, he's fouled.
Let's watch the play here. The ball is kicked loose on the last play. Mark Allery just wants it a little bit more there than Lamone Lampley. He outfights him for it, throws it length to the floor. The speed of Johnny Dawkins to catch up. Little right-handed play there by the left-hander Johnny Dawkins on the break.
That foul was going against Sperry. It's his first and only the 13th foul against Duke. Two shots now for Comagies. Dallas at a Roman Catholic high school in Philadelphia. DePaul now 4 of 10. This guy has been in double figures, 23 of 29 games this year. Set a school record in blocked shots, breaking the record by George Mikan. He has 187 in his career, 57 this year.
Right now, DePaul 1-3-1 half court trap. This is the defense they go to when they're in trouble.
Haverford kicks it off to Allery. Good ball movement by Duke. Dawkins short with that one. Tried to follow and almost got it. And then it's saved somehow by King. Boy, this is a very opportunistic Duke team. Off to Allery. Rebound inside, Ferry, and it's rejected by Lampley from behind. It will be Duke's basketball.
Well, Duke just pounding the offensive boards. That possession, they got 3 second shots. Johnny Dawkins with almost a spectacular follow-up. Didn't go, but Billy King was spectacular to play to pick the ball up and kick it back when he was laying on his back, and now they're going to inbound the ball. And right now it appears to me that Duke is just a little hungry, Gary. Every loose ball is theirs.
I tell you, when you're the top-ranked team in the country, you got to stay hungry because everyone's taking a shot at you.
Well, it's like the old gunfighter. You got to be ready to draw every night. Somebody's going to challenge you. You can't walk out in the street without being ready to draw.
Here's Henderson. He just checked in. He walked to the ball. That'll give it back to DePaul. 11:36 left in this game as Holmes will come back in. The senior with four fouls replaces Comagies. Well, if DePaul's going to win this ball game, they cannot allow that inside game to get away from them because that is their strength. And that last time down the floor, they were almost conspicuous by their absence.
They've got to do a good job on this possession. See if they can get something going inside. Dallas Comagies has been scoring at will the last few possessions. But right now, with him being on the bench, somebody else is going to have to pick up the slack.
Startling stat as Duke leading DePaul in offensive rebounds, 17-6. Here is Strickland. Saw Dawkins working harder there, tipped it off to his backcourt mate. Hamaker. Baseline. Henderson. And Duke is impressive. Biggest lead of the game, 56-43. Less than 11 minutes to go in the game. Lampley to Emery. They've been trying to go high-low all the time. Finally did it that time.
They got a good passing angle on the pass. Nice play there by Lamone Lampley. Marty Emery using those big, strong shoulders to pin the defensive man and get the easy basket.
Still haven't lost contact in this game. Duke wants to put the knockout blow in, but the ball team still clinging to it. Here's Allery from the baseline. They got so many ways they can explode, so many obstacles they can throw in your face. Allery was 17.
Well, you focus on Johnny Dawkins and Allery beats you. You focus on those two guys, and David Henderson hits you with a three-point play. So balance is the key, balance, depth, and their man-to-man defensive pressure.
And that's the reason they've won 18 in a row after losing two games back-to-back. Duke is on a 13-5 run. Terrence Green, nice-looking shot by the freshman. His first 2 points, 58-47. It's a physically demanding game, the way they're going up and down the floor and crashing the boards. Allery, and he is fouled as he goes up. As coming in now will be Jackson and Comedies. Embry committing his third foul.
Right now, Joey Meyer forced to make an offensive substitution. He's got to get his best offensive weapons on the floor right now. He's down 11, so he's got to come back with Dallas Comedies and Tony Jackson in the hopes those guys can give him some instant offense. But then on the other hand, these guys got to suck it up a notch and do a better job defensively. You can't trade baskets right now with Duke with having an 11-point lead.
18 points for Allery, 6 rebounds, all offensive in the second half. Well, this has been quite a three-game swing for DePaul. Joey Meyer under a lot of fire at DePaul. Took some of that pressure off, finishing this year an ordinary season into, thus far, a very spectacular finish. But right now, with 9:48 to go, the second-year coach, well, he's going to have to come up with some very good strategy. If you do not want to see the final score, we're going to put it up. I'm going to count to 5, so shut your eyes. Here's the score on Navy Cleveland State. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All right. You like that?
I feel like a kid that knows who won and wants to tell somebody. I got a secret.
Okay. 9:48 left to go now. 60-47. DePaul somehow has got to catch up, and they've got a lot of catching up to do. Duke, on the other hand, trying to win their 35th game of the year.
How about this? Duke showing zone. 2-3 zone. They're going to force them now to try to beat them from the outside to the 13-point lead. I knew that they were going to show it at some point during the game.
What would Bob Knight think of this?
He would say, well, he never coached me, speaking of Mike Krzyzewski. He's not one of my disciples.
There's a traveling call on Duke, so DePaul will get it back. 11 turnovers. Mike Krzyzewski, what Bob Knight was, Mike Krzyzewski is becoming, as he has really tried to adopt a lot of the Indiana mentors' tactics, coaching ability. And I can't think of a guy that you could learn much more from than Bob Knight, one of the outstanding coaches in the country.
You know, we have to talk about, too, his record when he took over there at Duke after he came in from Army. His first year, he was 11-17. You know, it wasn't smooth sailing for him. He struggled the first 3 years, and it's a recruiting class that he has on the floor now really turned it around for him.
Allery is an impressive rebound. 60-47. This is the best class, the senior class Duke has ever had. After that start that you talked about, they have come back to just be absolutely brilliant. Their record is 81-20 in 4 years coming into this game.
That's playing in the tough ACC conference and all the teams they play against in the non-conference.
Dawkins will reload it as Allery missed on the shot. 9 rebounds. Is there anything Dawkins can't do?
I don't see it. I tell you, he's exceptionally quick. I love his explosiveness, but his nose for the ball, he knows where, when the ball comes off the rim, to get in the right spot. That's an instinct that you don't teach. That's something that a kid is born with.
Amateur, beautiful pass. Holmes, though, blocked the shot, and it'll be off of Holmes. That was a sensational pass. Almost pulled it off, but Holmes, good defense. We're going to reset the shot clock to 45. 8:29 left to go in this game.
Right now, Mike Krzyzewski is going to force DePaul to come out of their zone. He said, we're not going to play you zone anymore. You've got to play us man-to-man. We've got the 13-point lead. Start chasing it.
8:13 left to go in the game. Perry who has outstanding basketball sense, which you might expect that his dad, Bob Ferry, the general manager of the Washington Bullets. Some of that kind of rubs off through osmosis. Ferry from outside, rebound by Rod Strickland. Strickland hung up again. That's twice now. He's gotten himself in trouble in midair. That's some of that inexperience you forget sometimes he's a freshman.
Well, you speak of Danny Ferry also. When he came in early on this year, he lost a little confidence. A lot was expected because Billis was hurt and he was starting. He put a little pressure on himself, lost some confidence, but at the end of the year, he's done a marvelous job as a reserve on this Duke team.
That foul on Strickland, kind of a frustration foul, and so Joey Meyer will take him out. Terrence Green will come back in. Strickland has gone against some outstanding players this year. I think about earlier this year, David Rivers of Notre Dame. He has grown up in a hurry. Of course, coming out of the Bronx, he had some streetwise basketball sense, but you still have to play major college ball to find out what it's all about. Amaker, by the way, is the only player that hasn't scored previous to that free throw. That's his first point of the game to go with six assists.
Well, one thing about Tommy Amaker, you never look at the box score and want to know what his contributions are. You never look at points. You look at assists, you look at steals, look at all the little things he does on the floor to force teams out of their offense. And I'd say he's as valuable as any player on this Duke team. You take him away, and they become a very ordinary basketball team.
And Coach K was saying he'll be more of an offensive scorer next year when Dawkins graduates. He is capable of being a scorer. He's relegated his role more to the point guard type as Holmes shoots one from outside, and Ferry is fouled by Embry. That is four on Marty Embry. Marty Embry also out of the Flint area. Some outstanding players have come out of there. Darryl Johnson playing at Michigan State. Eric Turner at Michigan. Two guys in this game, Green and Embry. Outstanding tradition as Ferry will go to the line. Ferry out of DeMatha High School. Morgan Wooten and the tradition they have there, very fundamentally sound, and that's what you expect from all DeMatha players.
And another thing about his game is he's not really an overpowering type player. He's more of a finesse player. You see the size of him, you expect him to be more of a low post player. He's really not that kind of basketball player.
Going to have a foul now on Allery, and that's only his first. For as effective as he has been, as physical as he's been, it's interesting that's his first foul.
His first person.
In the game now, Holmes with four, Jackson with four, Embry with four, Billis with four, Strickland with three. 7:17 to go, 61-47 Duke. Holmes can't get it, tries to follow, and Kamaji saves it in to Terrence Green. There's a nice pass to Holmes. Kevin Holmes playing a strong game. Been in foul trouble, but he had 6 points. 61-49. Embry and Allery really going after each other inside. That's the center for Allery. He and Embry collided, and Allery somehow saved it, but that would be backcourt if Ferry can't save it. Holmes comes up with it. Campbell is on. Kevin Holmes has it. Three on one. Jackson Holmes. Tell you what, that was a lot of effort by Kevin Holmes.
Well, great play there. That's the first time I thought in the second half that DePaul has really outfought Duke for the basketball. We've got a 10-point game right now, and DePaul slowly, you know, creeping back into this ball game.
Here's Henderson on the drive, and he had the lane, and he took it.
See, that's the weapons that you talked about. You're focusing on Dawkins, you're focusing on Allery. David Henderson isolates, takes in to get you that layup to break the momentum and give it back to your favor.
Inside Embry, and he's fouled by Henderson. Billis will come back into the ballgame, as will Rod Strickland. That foul going against Henderson, his third. And now, for the first time, Andy Lauchs, number 14, will check into the ball game. He's a perimeter shooter, outside shooter type. Jackson will sit down. Strickland has to wait to come in as Embry shooting the free throws.
Andy Lauchs in the game to try to bomb away against that zone defense. The problem is he becomes a defensive liability down the other end of the floor. So right now, Joey Meyer doesn't have much choice. He's got to find somebody to knock in an outside jump shot for him.
Desperation time for the ball. Embry hits it. That's a victory because he struggled all year long. 58% free throw shooter. He has 9 points in the game. This guy, by the way, has just been accepted to the Washburn Institute for Chefs. He wants to become a chef.
If you don't eat his food, he'll beat you up.
Now, I tell you what, with that body, he better be able to cook for himself because it's going to get awfully expensive otherwise. 63-53. 10-point lead for Duke. They can't put this team away, can they? They keep thinking they've got the ball, but yet the ball keeps fighting back. Here's Henderson on the drive. He's fouled by Lauch. That'll be his first. That'll stop it with 5:36.
Andy Lauch just didn't have the foot speed to try to come over and stop this during the 1-3-1 trap. Lauch trying to cover the baseline. He just can't get there. Actually, it was a good foul against David Henderson. Forced him to make the free throws, not give up the layup. At this point in the game, you can't give Duke any easy baskets.
One thing that has been very interesting about Henderson, and Coach K was telling us, that he plays his best in the big games. I recall he got 30 points against Kansas in that NIT championship game. Missing that free throw. You got to have a guy like that. His game comes up to the occasion. Well, they could cut it to 8 here. Green moving in, and they did.
What a great move there. A slashing move. Athletic move by Terrence Green. Getting his team fired up now. They're going to be into a man-to-man defense. They've gone out of the 1-3-1 trap. Look to see if they try to do a David Henderson against Andy Lauch.
They approach 5 minutes. You see it on the screen. It's an 8-point game now. Henderson taking Lauch inside. Backs it out to Allard. Dawkins changed the direction. Oh, was that pretty off the glass? 25 points for Dawkins. Does he remind you of anybody, Doug?
I was trying to think about that. It's hard right now to put a finger on it because he plays with such flair, but the way he was able to pull up and shoot that jump shot.
Look at Green. He's found a new life all of a sudden. He has just struggled offensively all year long, but now with 6 points, cuts it back to 8 points again.
You know, Dawkins is almost along the lines of a David Thompson kind of player, the spectacular leaper who can shoot the ball, can take it to the basket, just jump over the top of it.
Holmes rejected that one, and then Terrence Green commits a foul. That'll be the third on Green. Well, they've made a lot of analogies of Dawkins and Amaker maybe being the best backcourt duo in years and years. It's always hard to make those comparisons, but I'll tell you, Mike Krzyzewski wouldn't trade him for anybody else.
You know, if they're not the best, certainly they're the most complimentary. They talk to each other about knowing where each other is on the floor at all times. Boy, Gary, when you play with a guy that many games and you know what he's going to do on the floor, you make a move and you know a guy's going to be there to help you. And that's so important.
Henderson is 1 of 6 from the free throw line, and he leaves the door open. They could cut it to 6, believe it or not.
Green feels that he wants
to shot. Boy, ever. Look at this guy. That'll build for next year for him to finish like this.
And he wants the shot right now. He's saying, come on, guys, let's play some defense.
8 points for Green. All of a sudden, it's a 6-point game, less than 4 minutes to go. Who are these guys?
Well, DePaul does not want their season to end tonight.
A 12-4 spurt now for DePaul after it looked like they were on the ropes and going to be put away. Jackson playing the tough defense on Henderson. 15 seconds on the shot clock.
Look for Mr. Dawkins to pop off the screen, looking for the jump shot.
Allery will body it in. Doesn't get the roll. Lampley has a rebound, and we're going to have a foul on Kevin Holmes, and Holmes is fouled out as he's running away from the official as though he can escape the foul.
Boy, what a costly play, Gary, here. DePaul had the rebound, and the referee has ruled that Jay Billis was shoved in the back by Kevin Holmes on that rebound attempt after DePaul had possession of the basketball. Let's see if we can see it. The shot will go up by Mark Allery. He takes a tough shot, beating the clock. Let's watch Billis. That's where they said the push came about. It was hard to see really from that angle, maybe bodying him out underneath. But that's a key play right there because DePaul had the ball with the opportunity to go within 4.
Talk about a reversal. Joey Meyer was on his knees after he saw that, and now he throws the towel, and he has not been the type of guy to demonstrate very much emotion. They had the ball. They had a chance to come down to cut it to four. Instead, Holmes fouls out, and Phyllis is at the free throw line. He's not a good free throw shooter. And he gets the roll.
Well, he used all the rim that time, and that was a big free throw there as Joey Meyer continually to vent his frustration at the officials, but they had missed three straight free throws going to the line there before Jay Billis was able to use all the rim and get it to fall.
Well, that rebound by Lampley was an impressive one, too, but instead Holmes with a foul. So what they thought was going to happen did not. DePaul trailing by six, 3:22, and Joey Meyer is still hot. 67-59. This next sequence, Doug Collins, kind of shows, I think, the tenacity of DePaul, some of the effort that maybe was lacking when they were struggling earlier in the year.
Well, at this possession, they were actually down about 12 points, and they started making the run. Kevin Holmes, a great hustle, touch pass back to Tony Jackson, and the score, like you said, I really believe that that play would not have occurred about 10 games ago into the season. They, for some reason, when Joey Meyer went to his all-senior lineup, they just seemed to all come together. I guess these seniors didn't want their season to end the way it had been going along during the course of the year.
Trailing now by 8 points, DePaul with 3:13 left. Jackson off to Embry. He'll back it out to Strickland.
Duke back into that 2-3 zone defense, wanting to force that perimeter jump shot. Jackson looking for a seam.
As he gets it, Embry tries to get the rebound, and Allery has committed the foul. Mark Allery commits his second. That's his 16th foul, so one more, and DePaul will be shooting free throws. Embry got a great effort that time. He went up, suspended himself, and was able to draw that foul, and they'll inbounds now as Green will bring it in. 3 minutes exactly left in the game. Right inside Embry, and he stepped on the end line. Out of bounds, it'll be Duke's ball. 19 turnovers. Kind of a frustrating situation for DePaul. They've been close, but not able to turn the corner here at the very end. They had a chance to have it with 4 points the difference. Lost it on that costly foul. Now the inbounds got away from them. Duke will be in no hurry now.
They have a nice man in the middle there, Mark Allery, who's a good outlet receiver. He catches the ball. He makes good decisions, so when he catches it in the floor, he takes a look to see what he's got. If he doesn't like what he sees, he just turns and kicks it back out.
Hamilton kind of threw a dangerous pass that time to him, but he's able to get it. 6 seconds on the shot clock. Five, Henderson on the drive. And coming up with it is Billis. He's made some big baskets for this team this year. That's what Krzyzewski said about him. Doesn't score a lot, averaging 7 points, but he put a big one in there. He has six in this game, back to a 10-point lead. Green had a partially blocked. Duke will come out of it with Henderson operating with the ball. Out to Billis. Well, I got to give a lot of credit to DePaul. They did not tank it. They stayed in this game, really fighting it down to the end. And I know the seniors didn't want it to end, but you got to give them some credit. A different basketball team than we saw earlier.
Well, they pulled it within six in a tough play underneath the basket where they had the rebound and the foul was called against them, and actually became a play that I thought that ended the ball game right there. When that play was made, instead of going to four, Billis walked to the free throw line, knocked in two free throws, kicked it up to an 8-point lead, and Gary, they've not been able to get it back after that.
Comegys committed the foul, his fourth. Allery at the line. '70-59, 20 points for Allery. So they have two men with 20 plus. Dawkins and Allery leading the way. Seven rebounds as well. For the year now, he's had 12 20-point games. 71-59. Terrence Green, who looks like a different player right now, missed that one. Dawkins will bring it down. And so the Blue Devils will be moving into the championship game. Duke has run off a 6-0 spurt since that foul on Holmes, that costly foul when they thought they had the basketball. Instead, lost Holmes for the game. And the chant, we're number one, and no one can argue that point right now.
This Duke team is well schooled. They spread the floor nicely. They got their two guards out high, Allery in the middle, just looking to spread you out, force you to make a mistake, and then try to make something happen. There they've drawn the foul after using 35 seconds on the shot clock, and now Tommy Amaker will shoot a one and one.
And Tony Jackson's career has ended as he fouls out of the game. The seniors of Holmes and Lampley and Embry and Tony Jackson, the guys who didn't quit when I think everybody else had written them off, and they were telling me when their team was announced on our pairing show on March 9th, they were in the film room and they absolutely went crazy. They wanted to practice that night. Joey Meyer talked them out of it, said, we'll get ready tomorrow. But they got a new lease, a new chance to redeem themselves a little bit, and they did a very fine job of it.
Gary, the worst feeling in the world as a senior is to walk over that bench knowing you played your last moment of college basketball. It's an empty feeling. I never had the opportunity to play in the NCAA tournament like a Tony Jackson, but I do know that feeling of walking over and knowing that your career is over as a collegian.
Amaker makes it a 72-59 game. Dawkins has a game high of 25 points and 10 rebounds. As Henderson will lead. And for the first time, Kevin Strickland will come into the game. Strickland, 31, sophomore, is a very fine offensive player for Krzyzewski. With 57 to go, Amaker gets both of them. Strickland has a strip. Amaker lead to Quinn Snyder. Billis, he can't hang on. So Mike Krzyzewski's club will go to 35-2. And the 38-year-old is in the championship game at the Eastern Regionals as Strickland hits from outside. But it's too little too late. With 38 seconds to go, DePaul has one timeout remaining.
Duke
just about ready to register number 35 of the year. Your class for Duke. Look at that. 4 1,000-plus scorers. Dawkins, the all-time leading scorer at Duke. Allery, Henderson, Billis, and here's the man who has led them all year long as well as tonight.
Oh, a little crossover dribble there, right to left. Kissed it off the glass. Well, Johnny Dawkins not only can score, he plays defense, he rebounds. He's a total package. Some lucky NBA team is going to pick up a winner there next year.
Strickland will get it off to Snyder. We approach 30 seconds to go in this game. That's going to be off of Duke. In the ball game is Weldon Williams, number 40, a 6'6 senior from Park Forest, Illinois. Strickland will kick it out to Hawks. This shot a little flat. Lampley will follow, and Lamont Lampley will get it, and DePaul will ask for their final timeout with 21 seconds to go. Back to a 10-point game. Left here. Duke down by 10. Been a very trying, difficult game in a lot of ways. A lot of fun as Embry able to cut it to 8.
They're out of timeouts now.
They don't have any left.
Yeah, they can't stop the clock.
As a reach in by Green, and we want to take this opportunity to congratulate and thank the people we've worked with. Our executive producer is Kevin O'Malley. Our producer of this game is David Dinkins. Our director, Larry Cavallina. There they are. These people have put in a lot of time today. Kathy Beretta, our associate producer. David Graham, field technical manager. Bill Bunnell, our broadcast associate. And Mike Swanson, our all-universe statistician. Thank you, people. We've really enjoyed it.
You know, Gary, if there's one thing that Duke is going to have to do a better job of on Sunday, it's going to have to shoot free throws better. They have not shot the ball at the free throw line tonight. They've missed the front end of 5 1-and-1s. They're 19 for 32. When they get into a little bit closer ball game, they're going to have to do a better job of walking up and knocking in their free throws. They're a better free throw shooting team than this, 72% on the season.
That's right. That'll be something. When you win a ball game, you want, as a coach, want to find something to gripe about, right?
Oh, you can't.
Krzyzewski's got something.
You can't get too complimentary. Do you get it all done?
There's Strickland somehow able to get two more points. 2 seconds, one, this game is over. And Duke has won their 19th in a row. They go to 35-2. DePaul's season comes to a close. They finish at 18-13 for the year. For the first meeting of the year, or I should say the first meeting ever between these two ball clubs, and top-ranked Duke has captured the win. 74-67, Duke over DePaul. They'll move into the championship game in the East Regional. For Doug Collins, I'm Gary Bender. Now let's go to Jim Nance.
Shavlik Randolph, the waiting is over. The answer is next.